At the back of almost every single phone's user guide are instructions on how far to keep your phone from your body. Instructions which, in the most part, are wholly unworkable. And what happens when the telecoms industry funds research into the harm that they are causing? And that research concludes that there is an effect. That the use of a mobile phone does play a role in the development of cancer. They tend to keep that research to themselves.
We just don't know what we're storing up with EMF because the effects are largely long-term. And we have, as you say, this ubiquitous exposure and ubiquitous reliance on these exposures. We just don't fully understand yet what we're doing.
Although the epidemiology clearly shows that using a mobile phone increases the risk of contracting a brain tumour, what people like ICNIRP need to see is a definitive cause and effect. How it happens. What's the mechanism? How exactly is the cancer caused? It may seem obvious that a being so tuned in to the Earth's frequencies and so sensitive to her magnetic fields would naturally have a reaction to man-made microwaves. But for years, the telecoms industry have defended their actions by asking the same question. As it turns out, they've been asking the wrong question. The answer is melatonin.
You know, melatonin is a hormone, and believe it or not, it's made in the brain. It's made in the pineal gland of the brain, and it's got a very powerful antioxidant status compared with vitamins. For example, melatonin is 5 times as powerful as vitamin C. And twice as powerful as vitamin E. And it secretes only at night. And it's at night that we need it because that's when we go to sleep and when our brain repairs the cells of our body. And that's when melatonin comes out to do its work.
Each day, our body loses about 500 million cells. And at night, that's when our body replaces those cells through a process called cell mitosis, the dividing of cells.
And what it's doing is it's mopping up what are called free radicals. These free radicals are really the spare electrons left over from the process of making the energy which we need to repair our cells in the first place.
Each night, as our body repairs itself, millions of free radical cells are created as a byproduct of cell mitosis. These free radical cells attack healthy cells. It is universally agreed that the free radical cell is the main causal factor in most cancer. Our body's main defense against these free radicals is its most powerful antioxidant, melatonin.
It passes into the bloodstream, and its job is to act as a natural antioxidant, a natural anti-cancer agent. Melatonin is a very, very powerful anti-cancer agent.
What it does is it acts as a what's called an oncostatic agent, that is, it protects you against cancer. It controls the sleep-wake cycle, so that you get a good night's sleep when you've got proper melatonin. It's an anti-aging molecule. In other words, by mopping up those free radicals, it leaves your skin and complexion looking younger. We have in our lab 12,000 studies, which we've collected over the years. And that is more studies than have ever been published on paracetamol, which is the most common headache reliever. There's more scientific interest in melatonin than there is in paracetamol.
What are the consequences of having a reduced amount of melatonin? Yeah.
Well, you have a reduced amount of melatonin, and what happens then is that your immune system starts to be less competent, for a start. You tend to get sleep disturbance. You can't get off to sleep, or if you do, you wake up and can't get back to sleep. You can have heart complications because melatonin protects your heart as well. And you're much more prone to disease because your immune system is not functioning at its best. So these are some of the things that happen when you have a lowered melatonin level. And for example, the average woman with breast cancer has only got 1/10 of the melatonin of a normal woman of her age. And for people with prostate cancer, they've got less than half the melatonin that they should have. Autistic children have less than half the melatonin levels that they should enjoy.
Reduced melatonin in night shift workers, because they're working at night and exposed to light, they don't produce nocturnal melatonin, is known to produce a 50% increase in breast cancer risk. And the International Agency for Research on Cancer, IARC, has actually classed night shift work as a class 2A probable carcinogen because of this melatonin reduction.
There are lots of studies now showing that people on night shifts or people who are blind have different cancer rates than the average population. And most of those studies support the view that the absence or the lowered melatonin has an adverse effect on health.
Because the body only repairs itself at night, melatonin is only produced when the pineal gland senses that no light is present.
What happens is that the pineal gland is light sensitive. It's sitting right where your brain receives signals from your eyes at crossover point in the middle. It's called the suprachiasmatic nuclei. And the connections from there goes directly to the pineal gland to tell it whether there's any light around or not. If there's light around, then there's also interference with the signals the brain wants to send to our cells in order to repair them. So it says there's no point in the brain sending these signals out to our cells to tell them to repair, because there's so much interference that they won't hear it. So it waits, the brain waits until it's dark.
What kind of research has shown that there's an effect on melatonin production from electric fields, magnetic fields, radio waves?
Right, well, the Battelle Institute in America has done a lot of work on this way back from the late 1970s, in fact. And their scientists there, Barry Wilson and Dick Stevens and people like that, started thinking that because we know that if you turn the light on, then the brain stops making melatonin, they thought, well, maybe our brains can't distinguish between electric fields and that we make ourselves artificially, and the natural light that we all know happens during the daytime, because we just don't make melatonin in the daytime. for very good biological reasons. So they thought, well, maybe these electric fields are suppressing the synthesis of melatonin, and that in turn is leading to cancer, breast cancer particularly, in women, because they don't have the immunological protection that they would otherwise have.
So the brain interprets radio waves as being light waves?
Yeah, we don't know the difference.
The hypothesis that the pineal gland cannot distinguish between light frequencies and man-made frequencies is certainly backed up by a wealth of research. Do you think it's pretty conclusive that electric fields, magnetic fields, radio waves affect the production of melatonin?
This research, which shows that the kestrel melatonin levels fall with exposure, that white storks nesting on buildings near to radio masts have lowered progeny compared with stork nests a long way away from radio masts, studies on ants, studies on bees, and studies on birds of various kinds, studies on marine mammals, all point in the same direction.
But then there are studies in the laboratory of cells in the pineal gland, which actually synthesizes the melatonin, and looking at the effects of magnetic fields on those cells. And at virtually every stage in the synthesis of melatonin, it's been shown that magnetic fields disturbs the actual production of melatonin. So you see, the evidence is in all aspects of the pathway of melatonin production, that the inhibition of melatonin production by magnetic fields, the research covers really every aspect of that pathway.
Would you say that it's almost conclusive?
Yes, I would say it is almost conclusive.
The genius of our body means it is able to counter the production of free radicals with the production of melatonin. We have created in ourselves a precise balance, a perfect system of defense. It has taken our body millions of years to perfect this technique. A technique created based on the surroundings we have evolved in. But over the last few decades, our surroundings have changed, and changed exponentially. To the naked eye, the world appears to be the same. But at a cellular level, it is the biggest change in environment life has ever encountered. It stands to reason that such a gargantuan change would inevitably upset such a delicate balance. And the consequences of our bodies not producing the right amount of melatonin could be disastrous. Scientists around the world now believe that free radicals could be the causal factor in every known disease, not just cancer.
In the beginning of the 1900s, childhood leukemia was a medical rarity. We've seen nothing but an increase in childhood leukemia ever since that point. It's going up every year by about 2%. And that applies to many other disorders as well. Autism, brain tumors, cancer. cancer rates in the 1910s were probably half of what they are today. And many other diseases are being connected by studies, by scientific studies, with exposure to electromagnetic fields and radiations. Not just power lines, but also to radio fields and microwave fields. Because we've in the last 50 years really, we've immersed ourselves in an ocean of electromagnetic radiation. It's all around us now. Invisible, we can't see it, but we know it's there. Every time you lift up your mobile phone, you know it's there.
It's very, very hard to turn the clock back, or if not impossible to turn the clock back, but we need to be aware of the adverse health effects so that we have the choice of taking precaution against the exposures, if that's what we wish to do, that's what we need to do.
What worries me are things that are actually happening now.
Right.
That we haven't paid enough attention to, perhaps. And one of the things that's happening is autism, or give it its proper name, autistic spectrum disorders.
Do you think we're getting to a point in science where we almost don't have a control group to be able to test things like this? Because almost everybody has a mobile phone, almost everybody has Wi-Fi, almost everybody is exposed to electromagnetic fields.
Yes, we are reaching a situation where so many people are exposed to electromagnetic fields from mobile phones and Wi-Fi that we no longer have a control population to look at the difference between people, the health of people who are exposed versus the health of people who are not exposed. I mean, if I can take an analogy, we did find out that smoking caused lung cancer. That was because some people did not smoke. And they were a control group. If everyone had smoked, we may never have found that smoking caused lung cancer. And everyone would have been dying of lung cancer, and it would have been regarded as a sort of natural disease without ever having a link with smoking. What's happening with mobile phone exposure is we are losing this population of people who are not exposed. Even the few people who don't own a mobile phone are surrounded by the radiation from the mobile phone when they go shopping, when they go on a train, wherever they go.
It's not just the canary down the mine like myself. Eventually, if you simply increase the electromagnetic fields in the atmosphere, which we're doing, and we've now got a million times more electromagnetic fields, microwaves in the environment than we had 30 years ago, eventually it'll start to affect you.
It's very, very hard to say where we might be in 15 years' time, but I would very much hope within a few years' time we do recognise just how much these ill health effects are actually costing society. And then we might wake up and look at the causes and realise we have to do something about the causes.
We are a brilliant yet complex organism. The way that our body functions isn't by chance, nor is it something which has happened overnight. Like every other creature on this planet, we have adapted into the environment we exist in. An environment which, since the beginning of time, has had a delicate balance of fields and resonances. These phenomena don't just surround us, they make us what we are. The cells of our body communicate with each other using light frequencies. Our DNA uses electromagnetic frequencies to reproduce itself. At the core of everything are protons and electrons, positive and negative, making all life magnetic. We are, as all life is, equipped with cryptochrome cells, which allows us to sense those fields in ways we barely understand. We are beings of frequency, electricity, light, and magnetism. And to become this way has taken millions of years, a process which started with the very first cell. although we have embraced the wireless technology and accepted it into our everyday lives, at a cellular level, our bodies haven't. The frequencies that now surround us are as alien to our cells as they would be to our eyes, if only we could see them. Our children are being born into a world that their bodies simply cannot understand. Where will all this lead? As this film is being made, 4G technology is being rolled out around the world. To accommodate this, the ceiling levels are being increased. Wi-Fi is in almost every single home, school and business, surrounding us constantly. Deck phone technology is the norm in almost every single household. At a time when the industry's responsible should be displaying caution, they are displaying a reckless disregard for our long-term health. Money talks. And they are about as likely to develop a conscience as the tobacco industries did. If there's going to be a change, it's not going to come from them. It's going to have to come from us. We just need to open our eyes and see the problem.
Would the MTHR, do you think, fund research into radio waves affecting melatonin, given that this is the mechanism that people seem to point to, that mobile phones affect the production of melatonin? Melatonin is an antioxidant, a free radical vacuum cleaner, if you like.
When we issue a call for research proposals, as we're doing at the moment, while we highlight areas that are of particular interest, we invite applications, proposals across the spectrum. But it would have to be prioritised alongside the other applications that we get. We only have a limited pot of money. But we don't rule out funding research on melatonin. It's not one of the areas that we've identified as a priority at the moment.
I'm going to show you a simple and very effective way of shielding radio frequency radiation in your bedroom. Radio frequency, or RF radiation, is a form of non-ionizing radiation emitted by things like cell towers, Wi-Fi, cordless phones, and smart meters. So here, I'm holding an RF meter. Watch closely the meter as I zoom in. The flashing lights show the level of RF radiation in the room. The left-hand display shows the peak RF radiation readings in volts per meter. The readings are averaging about 0.05 volts per meter here. So I'm going to install an RF shielding canopy over this bed. This actually comes in two components. The package on the left contains the canopy, and the package on the right here contains the ground sheet. You can install just the canopy over your bed, but it's unlikely you'll reduce your exposures significantly. To effectively shield, you need to create an enclosed area, which means laying a ground sheet underneath the bed. The canopy and ground sheet I'm using in this video are for a single bed, and so a little bit small for this double bed. That's why before doing the test, I laid the ground sheet on top of the bed to make sure it was big enough. This is okay for the video, but if you're shielding a double bed, I recommend you buying a double bed canopy and ground sheet. So now I've got the canopy and ground sheet set up. The canopy I'm using here comes supplied with a fiberglass ring, which you insert into the top of the canopy to give you more room when you're underneath it. It doesn't change the shielding performance of the canopy, so I didn't use it for the video here. So, now you can see we've got flashing lights and the audio on the RF meter. This tells us that there are some fairly significant RF radiation levels in this room. Now watch as I take the RF meter inside the canopy. The meter I'm using here is a very sensitive RF meter, which can pick up very low levels of radiation. But as you can see, now I'm inside the canopy, it's showing no significant levels of radiation. This proves how effective a bed canopy and ground sheet like this are in shielding from RF radiation. Unless you live in an area away from cell towers, smart meters, Wi-Fi, cordless phones and other wireless technologies, you can expect your bedroom to have the level of RF radiation shown in this video. A bed canopy and ground sheet is the simplest and most effective way of shielding from these exposures. My name is Lloyd from electricsense.com. Thank you.